present Red for Danger, a new serial thriller in 6 episodes by Edward J. Mason. Episode 1, Ladies' Invitation.
She had flaming red hair, green eyes, and the milky skin that always seems to go with that sort of colouring. Her dress was green, too, what there was of it, and it clung to her figure like a wet bathing costume. Mark you, the dress had the right idea. It was the sort of figure anybody or anything would cling to, given the opportunity. For a few moments, I forgot all about Pat.
Go on, darling. Enjoy yourself.
Sorry, dear. What was that?
I would have said a penny for your thoughts, but they'd probably have needed censoring.
No, I was just looking at Red Farley.
Looking at her, did you say? You were practically licking your lip.
Oh, rubbish. Matter of fact, I was thinking what a marvellous model she'd have made for somebody like Toulouse-Lautrec. With that colouring, I mean.
Oh, yes. With that colouring, of course. Mind you, I always thought most of Toulouse-Lautrec's models wore clothes.
Well, Red's wearing clothes, isn't she?
Yes. But doing her best to disguise the fact.
Meow.
Well, David, you really were staring a bit.
Oh, you're jealous. After all, she is our hostess. Must take a bit of notice of her. Yeah, have some more champagne. It's good.
Hey, don't forget you're driving home, will you?
No, I'm not. I ordered a taxi. Been to one of the Farley parties before.
Well, I will say this. When they throw a party, they certainly do it in style, don't they?
No.
This must have cost a tidy bit. Has Paul Farley got such a good job as all that?
Oh, he's pretty well off financially, I think.
Yes, but he's only a research chemist, isn't he?
What do you mean, only a research chemist? Don't forget the Astron Iron Foundries are big. That Epel's done a pretty decent screw, same as old Vixor, his boss.
Ah, yes, but Kratz is the king pin so far as metal research is concerned. Even I know that. Paul's only his assistant.
Mm-hmm. And Paul's got his various patents of one sort and another. Hugo Norston looks after those for him. They'll bring him in quite a packet, I expect.
Well, if I'd got any patents or a wife like Red, I wouldn't have Hugo Norston around to look after them. I can't stand him.
Oh, he's all right.
He's got fishy eyes and he paws about with his hands when you're dancing with him. He's slimy, David.
Don't you go for that soft Nordic accent? I thought women liked it.
Here's one that doesn't, thank you very much.
A bit critical tonight, one way or another, aren't you? Now relax and enjoy yourself. I am.
So I see.
Anyway, our worthy host's heading this way. At least give the impression that you're having a good time.
The next dance will be a ladies' invitation, and ladies, excuse me, darling. The ladies will ask the men to dance and may also separate couples on the floor and dance with the gentlemen of their choice. Now, don't be coy, ladies. Don't be shy. It may not be leap year, but this is your big chance.
Oh, can't stand them, Bambi. They're too hardy for words. Oh, hello there, Paul.
Enjoying yourselves?
It's a heavenly party, Paul. I wish you had a wedding anniversary every week.
One thing I'm pleased about, Red's enjoying herself.
Oh, she always does at a party. That's what I love about Red. The fact that she's the hostess never seems to mar her enjoyment in any way. She always starts the party off in the right mood.
Thank goodness. I might tell you, I was worried.
What about?
About Red. She's been having frightful fits of depression.
Really?
Don't tell her I said so, but she's been scaring all of us stiff.
Red? Depression?
Mm.
Oh, I can't believe it. She's the last person in the world, surely.
So you'd think. But what would you say if I told you that twice I'd found her on the point of... Oh, well, let's forget it. This is a party.
Oh, now, don't be aggravating, Paul. On the point of what?
Oh, I shouldn't have mentioned it. On my mind so much, that's the trouble. Look, have some more champagne.
No, thanks. Our glasses are full already. Look, what is the trouble, Paul?
She was on the verge of committing suicide. Twice.
No. No, Paul.
Fact.
But why?
Wish I knew. We thought she must be going out of her mind or something. But thank heaven she seems her old self again tonight. Looks like it anyway. Oh, let's talk about something else quickly. She's coming over.
How are you making out with Victor Kratz these days?
Oh, fine. He's a genius, you know. Uh-huh. Absolute genius. He's going to astonish the metal world very soon. They're in for a shock. Hello, dear. How goes it?
I've not come over here to ask you to dance, Paul, darling. I'm grabbing David before Pat nips in and stops me.
Oh.
Go right ahead. Matter of fact, he's been dying for the opportunity to hold you in his arms ever since he got here.
And who'd blame me?
But I warn you, Red, when it comes to dancing, David's the original man with two left feet.
I'll chance it. Come on.
In which case, Paul, may I have the pleasure of this dance with you?
I shall be honored.
Well, Red, you look very ravishing tonight. Oh, you always do, but tonight particularly so.
You say the nicest things. Mind you, this frock is one that was designed to please all the men and annoy all the women.
I see what you mean.
I bet there are one or two bitchy remarks being made about it all the same. Still, David, you're a jeweler.
Go along. Damn. Sorry, not to worry. Go on. I'm a jeweler. Well, what's that got to do with a frock?
Well, if you've got any particularly appealing pieces of jewellery, you dress your window to show them to the best advantage, don't you?
Surely.
Same with my frock.
Really, Mrs. Farley, and you, a respectable married woman.
Well, they know about a respectable married woman. A very worried one.
No, I'm sorry about that. Look, let's go on to the terrace and you can tell me all about it, huh? Anyway, my dancing isn't what it should be. Now then, what's on your mind? What's your worry?
Hmm? No, David, you first. I gather you've something to worry about.
Hmm?
Well, just now when I mentioned about your being a jeweler, anything serious?
Oh, no, I just remembered it's Pat's birthday the day after tomorrow.
Don't tell me you'd forgotten it until now.
Oh, no. As a matter of fact, I've had a gold charm bracelet made for him. One of our old chaps. He's retired now, but he made it for me. He's a wonderful craftsman.
Well, then what are you worried about?
Well, you see, I collected it today, and the old boy hadn't a jewel case to put it in. So he popped it into an empty cigarette box.
Cigarette box?
An old 100 carton. Just remembered in the rush to get changed in time, I put it on the sideboard. Silly thing to do. Anybody could walk off with it.
Well, your flat's locked, isn't it?
That's the trouble. It isn't. Lock's jammed somehow, and I can't fix it. They've been meaning to do something about it for days. Still, there's always the porter on duty.
Oh, well, if the bracelet's in a cigarette box, it's probably safer than if it was in a proper jewel box.
Oh, well, let's stop worrying about it. Now, what's on your mind?
David, tell me. You've worked with the police once or twice, haven't you?
Why, yes. Inspector James and I are very good friends. Why?
What would you advise a woman to do if her husband went around telling everybody she was going crazy and trying to commit suicide?
It would depend how much truth there was in what the husband said.
Do I act crazy to you?
No.
Do I seem like a depressive suicide type?
Frankly, no. Last person on earth.
Yet Paul and Lush Baker and Hugo, they all keep trying to convince me that twice they've caught me sleepwalking. And each time I've been in the act of trying to kill myself.
You've been doing this in your sleep, you mean?
So they say, and I don't believe it. Well, would you?
But, if they actually caught you in the act, well, maybe there's something in your subconscious.
Oh, stuff and rubbish. I've never had a subconscious.
Yes, but why on earth should they want to kid you that you're in a suicidal frame of mind if you're not?
That's what I want to find out. And I think I've found out. There are several reasons. And one of them is coming across here with a gleam in her eye right now.
Oh?
She's going to excuse you.
The blonde?
Yes, Paul's secretary, Gloria Baker. Known to all and sundry as Lush. Short for luscious, for obvious reasons.
Paul knows how to pick his secretaries, doesn't he?
Didn't say that again. Anyway, this time she's going to be unlucky.
Huh?
Excuse me, Red.
Pardon?
I said excuse me.
Oh, it's you, Lush.
May I dance with Mr. Conway, please?
I might have guessed it would be you.
What do you mean?
Well, whichever man I happen to have, you always like to try and take him away from me, don't you?
I don't think that's very funny, Red. Mr. Conway?
Of course
I'm sorry, Lush, but you'll have to wait until the next dance. I'm exercising a hostess's prerogative, and I'm not allowing Mr. Conway to be excused.
I see. How very embarrassing for you, Mr. Conway. Later, then, perhaps.
Naughty of you, Red.
I can be a lot naughtier than that, where she's concerned. And she's got Paul completely under her thumb.
Oh, rubbish. Every wife always imagines her husband's having an affair with his typist. They think it's a sort of occupational disease with secretaries.
Oh, don't try to kid me, my sweet. I've lived too long. I was telling you, David, I'm worried. I honestly don't know what to do about the way Paul's acting. If he tells enough people that I keep trying to commit suicide, and then one day somebody does find me dead, well, people's minds will already be conditioned to the idea that I've killed myself. Whereas, in reality...
In reality? What?
In reality, Paul will most probably have done it. I want you to remember that, David. Don't ever forget it. I should never kill myself. Perhaps if anything should happen...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.